Afternoon, everybody. How are you? I am really happy to see you. Thank you for being here. So how was your week? Did you enjoy the week or not really? So? Okay, if you are working on a computer, on a desktop computer or a laptop, if you press the space bar, you should be able to unmute yourself. Could you please try? Okay, I think it is working. So we could try that. You could keep muted, and when you want to participate, just press the space bar and I will listen to you. Okay. Before we start, I need an artist, a person who really enjoys drawing. Is anybody here who wants to be the artist? Okay, I can see Kate. Kate, you will be our artist today. The purpose is you understand everything I say. And as you listen, you will draw. Just remember the rules. Okay, I have a sample here. It doesn't have to be a piece of art, but just make sure you use colors. The drawing should be large so we can all see it. If you have markers and use bold lines, that will be perfect. Okay, excellent. So Kate is our artist. Okay, I'm still admitting people into the meeting. So just remember, Kate, during the lesson, I will ask you, hey, artist, so far so good? And at some point you will send me your drawing, a picture of your drawing through the chat. Okay, perfect. So Kate is our artist. I need professor number two, someone who will help me. Okay, and Rene. Rene will be our professor number two. So Rene, during the lesson, I will ask you, professor two, professor dos, what do you think? A or B? And you will give me your opinion. The rest of you, you only need to follow the rules. These are our classroom rules. Number one, listen with the intent to understand. Number two, one person speaks, that is me, and the others listen. Number three, suggest cute answers, avoiding English. Only that, it's all about the interaction. There are no right or wrong answers in comprehensible input. All kinds of answers will be correct. Okay, so I guess now we are ready to start. Okay, we have our artist, Kate, professor number two, Rene. Well, hello class, let's start. Do you have your cards with you?
Hurry.
Okay, just show them to the camera. I really want to see them. I see Karin, Rene, Susan, Denise. Denise, is that dancing or boxing? Okay.
I'm a terrible artist, you guys. It's supposed to be salsa dancing.
Okay. Thank you, Kate. Is that a teddy bear, Kate?
Yeah, I do. I make toys out of crochet.
You crochet toys. Yeah, you go.
Okay, Kate. You know, I like Denise's card. Let's talk about Denise today. So remember, before we start, please make sure you can see me and hear me well, and also make sure you can see the board. Let's start. Remember my objectives, my two main objectives as a teacher. I want to be as comprehensible as possible. I want to be as engaging as possible. Clase. Denise. Baila. Baila.
Baila.
Baila.
Baila.
Baila.
Baila. Baila. Baila. Baila.
Baila.
Baila.
Denise. Baila.
Baila.
Baila. Baila. Denise, baila.
Denise, baila.
Denise, baila.
Denise, baila.
Clase.
Baila. Denise, baila.
Que. Que baila, Denise.
Thank you.
Jack. Sí, Jack. Excellent. Clase. Denise. Baila.
Cumbias.
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 Denise baila cumbias.
Cumbias.
Denise baila cumbias. Denise baila cumbias. Denise baila cumbias. Denise
baila cumbias.
Denise baila cumbias.
Denise baila cumbias.
Correct. Wonderful class. I love it when you try the sounds of the language. Excellent. That's it. Denise baila cumbias. Susan. Are you there, Susan? Yes, no, maybe.
Yes.
Denise
baila cumbias.
¿Quién baila cumbias?
Denise.
Denise.
Perfecto.
Denise.
Excelente. Denise baila cumbias.
Denise baila
cumbias. Denise baila cumbias. Muy bien. Veronique. ¿Qué baila Denise?
Cumbias. Cumbias.
Excelente. Perfecto. Muy bien. Clase. Denise baila cumbias. Denise, no.
Sí.
Show me with your hands. No.
No, no, no.
Denise,
no.
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 Baila salsa.
No baila salsa.
No baila salsa.
Denise baila cumbias. 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 Clase.
Deja acá, pero tú dijiste del programa.
¿Dónde?
Bueno, lo quitó al hombre, el hombre.
¿Dónde?
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 ¿Dónde? Baila cumbias. Venís.
En Zumba class.
Tokio.
Okay.
En su casa. En su casa.
In the principal's office.
Oh. I love your answers. Profesor Dos. What's the answer?
In la oficina, in the principal's office.
Okay, excellent. Denise, baila cumbias. Class, show me. Clase, show me. Sobre.
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 Debajo.
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 En. Excelente. I could see everybody doing this. I love it when you all do this together with me. And you know something? This is the sound of your grade going up. Every time you do it, my heart rejoices. I feel so happy. Excellent. Yes. Clase. Denise baila cumbias. And la oficina.
En 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 la oficina. Ok, perfecto. En la oficina, Denise baila cumbias. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina.
In the kitchen?
No, en la dirección.
No, no.
En la oficina.
Oh, en la oficina.
Excelente, muy bien. Thank you, Frank. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina. En la oficina, Denise baila cumbias. Clase.
Ah, ¿con quién?
Con el director.
El director. Okay, I love it.
Of course, the student would have said with the principal. And of course, you would say director. Yeah.
Clase, show me. Everybody, I want everybody. Excellent.
Sobre.
Perfecto.
Sobre, sobre. Debajo, debajo.
Excelente. Muy bien. Clase. Denise. Baila cumbias. En la oficina. Con el director. Perfecto. Clase.
Ando.
Cuando baila cumbias Denise con el director.
At midnight.
En la mañana.
Mañana.
En la tarde. En la noche.
En la noche.
Perfecto. Muy bien.
En la noche.
En la oficina. Con el director. Denise. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina con el director en la noche. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina. ¿En la escuela?
Sí, en la escuela.
No, en la oficina.
Ridículo. Denise, no. Show me. Denise, no. Baila.
En la escuela.
Denise, baila cumbias.
En la oficina.
Denise baila cumbias en la oficina con el director.
Con el director.
En la noche. Okay. How is our artist doing? So far, so good. Okay, don't show it just yet. Just keep it secret. Thank you. Okay, so Kate, we are not adding any more details. So whenever you want to send it, that's just fine. Okay, thank you so much. Okay, clase. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina.
Con el director.
Con el director.
En la noche.
En la noche. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina con el director en la noche. Clase. Denise baila cumbias con el director en la oficina en la noche. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina con el director en la noche.
Con el director en la noche.
En la noche con el director, Denise baila cumbias. Okay, excellent. Denise baila cumbias. No baila salsa, no baila rock. Denise baila cumbias. En la oficina con el director. ¿En la mañana?
No.
No.
¿En la tarde?
No en la mañana. No, 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 en la tarde.
No en la mañana. No en la tarde.
No en la tarde.
La noche.
La noche.
En 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 la noche.
Perfecto. Okay, I guess Kate is sending us the drawing. So while we wait for her, we can start quiz number one. Okay, Tanya, would you like to ask something?
Where is she dancing?
Free dancing?
Where is she dancing?
Oh.
En la oficina.
En la oficina. Okay, class. Let's do quiz number one while we wait for Kate's drawing. I'm going to share my screen. And let me know, can you see it?
Yes.
Can you see my cursor highlighted in blue?
Yes.
Okay, so let's use our daily quiz template. Please write your name, the date, and your student number. Let's do quiz number one. You will answer. Yes, sí, show me, sí, sí,
sí,
sí, or no.
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 Okay. Question one. Pregunta uno. Pregunta uno. Clase. Denise baila cumbias.
Sí.
I want to see everybody. Come on. Okay. Excellent. Yes. Correct. Yes. Denise baila cumbias. Yes. Pregunta, question. Pregunta.
Dos.
Dos. Pregunta dos. Pregunta dos. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina. Perfect. I can see everybody doing. Okay, yes, correct. Denise baila cumbias en la oficina. Pregunta, question, pregunta. Tres. Pregunta tres. Denise baila cumbias con Victoria. Perfecto. No, ella no baila cumbias con Victoria. Denise baila cumbias con el director. Clase, pregunta 4. Pregunta 4. Denise baila cumbias en la noche. Okay, everybody. Okay, excellent. I can see everybody answering. Yes. Denise baila cumbias en la noche. Clase, pregunta 5.
Cinco.
Pregunta 5. El director baila con Denise.
Sí.
Correcto. Sí. Excelente. Denise baila con el director. El director baila con Denise. Correcto. Muy bien. We have answered quiz number 1.
Hey, Jesús.
Yes.
You know what I think is very good is that you're always evaluating their answers. Ridículo, correcto. And it's all understandable because it's basically mostly cognates, right? So, that's, you know, right. You're using a lot of vocabulary that's extra, but you don't have to explain it because either the situation and or the cognate idea, you know, makes it explanatory. That's perfect. That's very good that, you know, that's squeezed in there.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Frank.
Yeah.
Thank you. Kate, friend, are you there? Okay, Kate.
I sent the image to your
to my email.
I sent the image to the email. I couldn't get it to go in the chat. Yeah.
Okay. I think I got it. Oh yeah. Oh yes. Okay, class. I'm going to share my screen. Please give me a thumbs up when you see my screen, okay? Okay.
That's beautiful.
Qué bonito.
Qué bonito.
Qué bonito. Qué bonito dibujo. Qué bonito dibujo. What a nice drawing.
Qué bonito.
What a nice drawing. Qué bonito dibujo. Clase.
And this is good too, because you got some Spanish that you're not going to hold them to, but hopefully they pick some of it up, especially over time when you do this again later on. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Frank.
Yeah.
Clase. Denise baila. Baila cumbias.
Cumbias.
Yeah. ¿Con quién?
Con el director.
Yeah.
Denise baila cumbias en la oficina con el director. Can you see the moon?
Yeah, sí.
What do you call the moon in Spanish?
La luna.
Luna.
Luna, la luna.
And this?
Una estrella.
A star.
Ellos,
una estrella.
Denise y el director, ellos bailan en la noche. En la noche. En la noche.
En la noche.
And we see
la noche.
The moon, la luna. Y las estrellas.
Ah, las estrellas.
La luna y las estrellas. En la noche.
Y las estrellas.
La música, la música.
La música.
La música.
Cumbias. Cumbias.
Cumbias.
We will talk about cumbias later in the extend phase. When we talk about culture, a cumbia is a traditional dancing from Colombia. Okay, excellent. Clase, let's applaud, un aplauso para nuestro artista.
Bravo, 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 bravo.
Excelente, gracias. Okay, the next part is the writing quiz. I'm going to share my screen again. In the writing quiz, you only have to copy the text, okay? Okay. Let me take a picture very quickly so I don't forget any question. Before I continue, is it easy for everybody to read this? Perfect, thank you.
Punto.
Punto. Okay, quiz number two is just copying the text. Please give me thumbs up when you are ready. Thank you.
Wait, to get it a little closer.
Okay, and it's much better now. Okay, let's continue class. Good. Now, I read, you listen, only that. Denise baila cumbias con el director en la oficina en la noche. Ellos son amigos. Denise baila cumbias con el director en la oficina en la noche. Ellos son amigos.
Ellos.
Son now, amigos. I'm going to give you 30 seconds to read the text silently. Give me thumbs up when you are ready. Okay, thank you, Karine. Thank you, Frank. Thank you, Okay, Carrie. Thank you, Veronique. Okay. Clase, the next exercise is called choral translation. Choral translation. I need a leader, but it's not any kind of leader. It's a reading leader. Is there a volunteer to be the leader to read with me? Okay, thank you, Renee. Renee, you and I are going to read this text. The text is in Spanish. We're going to translate it into English. I'm going to read some words. I'm going to stop. And then you repeat after me in English. And the rest of your classmates are going to try to repeat with you. You will try to synchronize. They won't do it before or after. They will do it exactly at the same time. But your voice, Rene, your voice is the reference. Okay, is everybody ready? Before we start, please make sure you can mute and unmute yourselves. Remember, I'm just going to listen to a chorus. I'm going to listen to a bunch of voices. Okay.
The mic again.
Tres, dos, uno. Denise dances cumbias.
Denise dances cumbias.
With the principal.
With the principal.
Okay. One more time. Let's do it together one more time.
Denise dances cumbias.
Come on, everybody.
With the principal.
In the office.
At night.
They are friends.
That's
it. Muy bien. Excellent.
Bravo.
You synchronized. Wonderful. The next part of the class is called grammar discussion. Grammar discussion. Ellos son means they are. Amigos means friends. Denise baila means Denise dances.
Underline the S with dances.
Oh yeah, thank you, friends. Okay, and that's all the grammar we are going to study today.
I had a question, teacher.
Oh, yes, Frank, go ahead.
Well, you told us at first that N means in, but then later you told us en means at.
Oh, yes. You know, in English, there is a difference between in and at, but in Spanish, it is always en. Okay, class, what we are doing next is this. I'm going to share my screen one more time. Okay, we have already done quiz number one. You answered yes or no. We did the writing quiz, quiz number two. That's just copying the text. You did that.
Yeah.
Now let's move on to translation quiz. You're going to write the English translation. We did that orally. Now you're going to write it. Write it here. Okay, I'm going to give you just 1 minute. When you are ready, please give me thumbs up.
That's good.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. Lorik? Lorik Dale? I'm sorry, friend. I'm having difficulties to pronounce your name.
This is Lori.
Okay.
Kinzel's my last name.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Jesus, Jesus.
Yes, Frank.
Back to the grammar. Since we got ellos, would it be wrong, since we underlined the S here with the dances, would it be wrong to put ella under the Denise? Put ella, because they already got ellos, just, you know, yeah. And say that means she, and, you know, means Denise, means she, yeah. Yeah, I think that's maybe a good idea. I don't think it would hurt, yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Frank. Okay, class. Okay, let me move the camera a little bit. We did the yes, no quiz. We did the writing quiz. You just did a translation quiz. Now let's move on to quiz number four. That is called dictates a dictation exercise. What I'm going to ask you to do is put away your text. I want you to depend on what you hear. You are just going to listen to me. For this exercise, it is extremely important, extremely important. There are no interruptions. So for that reason, please keep muted. No interruptions. No looking at the text. Actually, I'm going to move the camera a little bit so you cannot see the board, okay? You're just going to listen to my voice. I am going to dictate one sentence and I'm going to say it three times. I'm going to share my screen now. Right here, we're going to use the first three lines only because it's only one sentence. In this format, there is a space for four. The first time I say the sentence, just listen to it. No writing, just listen to it. The second time I say the sentence, please write it right here on the first line. The third time I say the sentence, I want you to double check your work. Okay, once we do that, I will tell you how to use the second line. I want to stop sharing my screen. Remember, don't look at your text. Try to understand what I say. The niece baila cumbias con el director. Second time, now this time, right. Denise baila cumbias con el director. Third time, double check your work, please. Denise baila cumbias con el director. Okay, great. Now, I will show you the text. And this time, you're going to compare your text with the text I will show you on the board. If there is something different, I want you to circle the word or the part that is different. And you're going to write the correct version on the second line. However, remember that your grade is not based on having everything, every single word correct. It's about recognizing the parts that are different. Okay, let me show you the board. Denise baila cumbias con el director.
And you could have taught punto in the dictée.
Oh, yes. Oh, I forgot that, but that's important. Thank you, Frank.
Yeah.
Because it's the end of the sentence.
Yeah, and it's an easy word for them to get, you know. Yeah.
I have to say,
yeah,
punto. Punto, Denise baila cumbias con el director.
Yeah.
Punto.
Yeah, and then maybe, you know, sometime later, you know, maybe a couple of weeks later, you can teach capital D or capital L, you know. You know,
that's right.
But not now, you know, later, another time.
Thank you, Frank. There are different possibilities as you can see. But you do really depends on the level of your class.
Right, exactly. And this is the first class, maybe even. So yes. you wouldn't teach capital D, that's too complicated, but punto is easy for the end of sentence, you know.
Okay. Also this part, like, as a teacher, you will know whether to introduce Aja.
Yeah, right.
Or not.
In any case, you will do it later in the reading, you know, when you make a more, you did that already, right, yeah. Oh, no, this is before we did the reading, right, yeah.
That's right.
But anyway, you know, it works out, however you do it, yeah.
Thank you, Frank. And so, well, that was our first Spanish class. I'm pretty sure you have lots of questions, so let's move to that part.
Excelente, maestro.
Gracias. Un aplauso.
Muy bueno, para todos. Jesús. Muy bueno, Jesús. Gracias.
Excelente class.
Gracias.
Students. very participative, very imaginative, great answers.
Yeah.
And finally, we saw the demonstration of the whole star from the beginning yeah. until the end. Hopefully my comments helped you guide yourself on the star to recognize the phases of the stars.
Yeah.
So how do you feel? How are the two last phases? Too hard? Any comments on that?
I want to make a comment, Victoria, if I may. I really enjoy the fact that I was able to see a structure in the whole thing from the beginning to the end. And mm-hmm. and especially the introduction of the quizzes as part of the whole development of the lesson. I think that's important to keep students focused because as we know, what they care about is the grade.
Somebody's mic.
Sorry. Okay. And somehow this thing, it keeps them like on their toes, right? And also it gives us permanent, as teachers, we receive permanent feedback from them. If they're working, they're not working, is they understanding, they're not understanding. Mm-hmm. The only thing that I'd like to ask Jesus, if it's possible,
can you
go over whatever you wrote in the board and stop in each place where you did the quizzes, because somehow I missed the quiz number two. You said the quiz number two is...
it's just writing.
Writing, but which one what you did was writing? Which one was the translation quiz?
Translation, well... We do translation translation quiz. That's quiz number three.
Yeah, but when did we do it? In what moment we did it?
After the grammar discussion.
So the choral translation is the quiz number four.
Quiz number four is the dictation exercise. Dictate.
Oh no! I'm sorry. The number three. The number three is what is the translation we did in three? Three is translation, right? Or not? Am I wrong?
Yeah. Quiz number three. Is a translation quiz.
Yeah, which text, one was that?
The text we wrote in Spanish, you write it in English here. You will be able to do this because before that, we did choral translation. So we did it orally.
Okay. So, but we didn't do it during the class.
Yes, we did.
Yes, you did.
We wrote it down?
Yeah,
I gave you. After choral translation.
I'm sorry, I missed that part. I somehow skipped from the retail to the choral translation.
It's okay, Estrella, no problem at all.
Maybe there's some confusion because we say writing quiz, but since there's such a low level, the writing quiz is really just a copy. They just copy what they see. We call it writing.
Yeah, this is a writing quiz.
Yeah, when you say it out loud and they wrote it down, that was a writing quiz.
Yeah.
Or we wrote it down. That was a writing quiz.
Yeah, we would just sit there copying, but actually for them it's writing because the spelling is new to them and all that, etc.
And then when we review it and correct it. But
okay, I see probably where the confusion is.
Yeah.
Okay. So first we created an image.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then I retold it.
Mm-hmm.
And in reveal, we describe the drawing. Then we move on to the writing phase.
Mm-hmm.
And I chose option one. I wrote the text and I added 10%. That part was ellos son amigos.
Mm-hmm.
Then I read it for you. Then you read it silently.
Mm-hmm.
Then we did choral translation and Rene was the leader.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think...
Actually, we didn't write anything here. We just translated.
No, we didn't.
This is just this is just... In choral translation, basically, we want to establish meaning. And we want to do it chorally because we don't want to put anybody in the spot. So in my opinion, as a teacher, it's quite important to say, we're going to I'm just going to hear a bunch of voices. I'm not going to hear anybody's voice in particular, but we need a leader. After that, we do grammar discussion. And basically in grammar discussion, I'm going to stop sharing my screen for a moment. Okay, what you want to do is just say, this means that, this means that, this means that, this means that. You don't want to use any technical words such as-
No, you might say like, you might say like an amigos, the S means more than one. And with the S in friends means more than one friend, you know, the same idea.
That is true. That's how grammar is explaining comprehensible input. This means that you explain grammar based on the meaning of the grammar.
Yeah.
Okay. And so once we do the grammar discussion, well, this part belongs to book number two. We do the translation quiz. So you say, okay, class, we have translated the text. We did it together as a group. Now it is your turn to translate it and write it. And you're going to do it, oops, okay, right here. After the translation quiz, we do the dictate, the dictation exercise. Right here. You know, this text is so short, but we only use one sentence. But as you keep on progressing, probably you want to dictate two, three or more sentences.
Have you taught with this structure like in high school or?
Yes.
Yeah.
Middle school and high school.
Yeah. So how do you do this? Like, do they keep a notebook in which they do this? Like in this, do you tell them this is a structure that you have to keep in the notebook? This is the parts that you have to write, and this is where you want to put. Or how does it work?
No, the important part, right, tell them is taking notes is busy work for you.
Mm-hmm.
The important part for me is that you interact with me. Show me you are understanding. You show that through gestures. You show that through your suggestions to create this description, to create this story.
Yeah, but I get that part, Jesus. What I'm concerned about is like, how can I say this? When you are like in the high school settings, right?
Yeah.
Students and parents expect certain structure. So I taught in 80% of my career as a teacher, as a college teacher. I never had to do any of this. When I started teaching in high school, I faced the situation that I had to give my students a structure so they can have somewhere to go back. So like a notebook or something. At the beginning, I used loose leaf pages, I used binders, and things started going better when I got a composition notebook. I gave them the composition notebook, say, because my school is a Title I school, so I purchased them for them. I gave each one of them a notebook, and every day we will label the date, where we put the goals for the day, and then we start doing activities, and then they will keep it all records, and then at the end, I will give them grades for completion, one grade in the school. And that way, those kids that were always distracted on how got to focus in the work we were doing in class. So when I saw the structure you had in that document, in that Google document, it's like a bulb turns on my head. I said, that could be the way to keep some structure during all the conversation, even though we, you and I, and everybody else here know that the important part is the conversation, the interaction, the responses. From the student side and the parent side and the administration side, they're going to see some notes that students have in a certain order, and they're going to know that the class is following a structure.
Yeah.
And that the teacher is doing something except in the class, not only like, you know, something random.
Okay, I'm going to show you how I do it. How mm-hmm. I did the last course, I created that.
Okay, that's wonderful.
A Google classroom group. And mm-hmm. I always tell the students, okay, don't worry about making notes or anything, because I will upload all of this onto the platform.
Okay.
And this is what I do. The date. This is what we created. This is an English class.
Mm-hmm.
This means that.
Uh-huh.
The drawing. And when they, okay. And once we have completed trip around the star, what they upload the quizzes. Okay. Let me see if I can find one. Okay, this one. The format, they upload it. It's taking longer than expected. Okay.
Oh, so you actually gave them that. That's great.
Okay. Oh yeah.
Excellent.
There is a Word file.
I love it.
They
yeah.
change it. I don't really grade this because that's something we already did in class. This is something to keep students accountable.
Exactly. Exactly. That's what an important part it is, that they know that they are not playing in class. They're actually doing something. They are learning. But you gave them this as a Google Doc you share with them and they fill it in during class?
I shared the files with them and I told them that we were going to use them every class. Before the class starts, I tell them, the material you need for today is your format
mm-hmm.
for the quizzes. Please make sure you write your name, the date, your student mm-hmm. number.
Mm-hmm.
And as we move along in the class, start answering. When we do quiz number one, you're going to show me through the camera, yes or no,
mm-hmm.
and you're going to answer on your format.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, quiz number two is just students copying. Quiz number three, well, the original text is in English. They translate it into their mother tongue. In this case, it's Spanish.
And Jesus, once they start doing free writes, you know, they'll have the composition book with their free writes, and the parents can actually see how mm-hmm. they're writing things that are understandable.
I'm going to show you
how they're improving. How they're improving with each free write they do later mm-hmm. on. You know, after 3 weeks or so. You know,
we did free writes also in this group.
Yeah.
Okay. Free writes three.
What level is this, Jesus? What Spanish level?
This is English. They are supposed to be right in the middle, but this is actually basic.
Basic English.
They are Mexican students learning English.
Oh, you're an ESL teacher.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay, and this is free writes. In free writes, they have 10 minutes to write a story. Ideally, a story similar to the ones we have been writing in class.
Mm.
And this is what this student wrote.
Okay.
Okay, now I'm going to open the... Because what I did, the way I did it online, I asked students to create a Google Sheets file. Okay, here it is. Okay. It's taking longer than expected. Okay. And they will, they will introduce all the information about free rights. Okay, free rights. So this is student, okay, Ibarra. I'm going to move this to the top. Okay, free writes. and the students created a file, a Google Sheets file, and they shared it with me through a link.
Interesting.
Well, it's still working. Okay. So let's take a student, any student. We do free rides every 3 weeks, ideally every 3 weeks. This student started writing 64 words the first 3 weeks of the course, and she ended up writing almost double. I ask students to illustrate
this. This is 10 minutes, right? 10 minute write, right?
Yeah, 10 minute writing.
Yeah.
We had three free rides during the course, and this is what happened. Right here, the student had a problem, maybe a personal problem, probably she was sick, we don't know, but in the end she improved. And this is what she was able to write. Well, at the end, okay. Well, this is how you monitor the student's progress through this file. They should be writing.
And can you show us that free write for just a little bit longer,
yeah,
please? Sure. Thanks.
So how do you know the amount of words? The students type the amount of words?
Yeah, when those 10 minutes are finished, they count the number of words.
Okay.
And they count them, they introduce a number here, but they type the number here. And if a parent wants to talk to you, well, you have all this evidence.
Jesus, do you give them any feedback on the free write at all or nothing at all? You just collect it, read it, make the benchmark assessment of where they were and where they're, you know, how much they've improved, and that's it.
I always praise them. When in comprehensible input, the students can't be wrong. They cannot make any mistakes. So as a teacher, what I do is when I read this, I start thinking, in what phase of acquisition is this student? What I have noticed is that they start incorporating the grammar, the vocabulary that we have been using while creating stories, using the stars, using the star. And so I decide probably I need to do card talk more, or probably they are ready to do one word images. Okay, we have done a lot of one word images. Now they are ready to do individually created images. And once I know they are ready, we can start creating not only descriptions, but maybe stories. Okay, now let's introduce a problem. Let's introduce a solution. And the 10% I add in the writing phase is, well, it's a lot longer.
Yeah, and in regard to structure, you know, we're not having to keep a record so much of what structures we taught as how they can use structure that we were teaching, because the important thing about structure, can they use structure even if they don't quite get it right, but they can use it well enough to communicate, and gradually they get it more in the correct English way, you know, rather than the funny looking Spanish way or Russian way.
Jesus, I was wondering how the grading goes, like in like the template, right? Does everybody get 100% every time?
Yes. As long as they are interacting with you, yes, they will get 100%.
Okay.
All the time. They upload their work, their quizzes, but I don't really check them because I know they did it in class. It works better if you do what Ben just told you at the beginning of the classes. You keep a notebook. You have two columns, like
right,
and you keep them accountable. If
it has happened to me that students, even though they take their lessons, they don't upload their work. Then I ask why? Mm. How come? If you did the hardest part, it's just uploading the work we have already done during the class. Also, free rides. It's important to make sure that they create the file correctly. Well, under these circumstances of the pandemic, okay, create the file, upload it, share it with me, type the number of words you have written. I want to see your progress. Yeah, it's important you interact with me, but as a teacher, at some point you need to collect evidence. In case you need to talk to administrators, parents, even the students to show them their progress. Every time I talk to students to show them their progress, I just praise them. I just want to make them feel good about themselves.
Do you ever get accused of grade inflation?
No, not at all. And talking about comprehensible input, because we know how languages are acquired, there's really no scientific evidence that counting the number of correct answers, getting a grade, will actually help students acquire the language. Students will acquire the language because they will listen to it repeatedly many times. They can't be wrong. If anybody is wrong, it's the teacher, but not them. I mean, it's 50% for interaction. And also you can see that the free rides. Free rides is wonderful because the students can notice. You don't really have to tell them, but they are improving. And even if they write less, the few words they wrote actually incorporate the linguistic elements we have used during the class. So that's good.
Oh, Jesus. And when you're interacting with the class, if you see somebody who's either doesn't seem to be paying enough attention or they don't seem to be understanding, but you look in their eyes and you see how they're responding to you, then you ask them, or maybe just the class in general, what did I say? What did that mean? What I just said.
Mm-hmm.
So you check them that way. That's one way of checking that they're really learning something or they're not learning.
That is true.
Jesus, I don't know if you have this experience, but I was thinking yesterday that what about if we not only have one picture for the whole class, but each student draws their own. And I was thinking that because...
Well, there is one activity like that.
Yeah, I was thinking the next year, maybe the next year, I thought I was ordering materials for the next year. And I was thinking maybe one of those primary notebooks that they use in elementary school, it could be good for the activity of this writing. So you have all the part in the bottom, you use it for the writing, and the top, the student will draw their own, maybe as a homework, maybe they take it home and in home do it, or maybe they do it during class. Maybe you learn about your artist. Maybe you have more than one artist, maybe people who really can express through pictures. I don't know. There could be a variant, but maybe it could help. I don't know. I think you were going against the philosophy of this, so it could fit.
No, there are four types of activities where there's a drawing. This one, it's the artist does the drawing, and there's another one where artist does a drawing, but there's another one where each student does the drawing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
I didn't know that. Oh,
yeah,
okay.
So there's different ways of doing this. You see, but we start out with this way because this is the simplest way.
Okay, all right. But the student do it previous to the class or do it while the activity is done in the class?
Well, the one they do previous to the class, this one type of activity where they do the drawing, and then they select, there's a process by they select the one that will be talked about in the class.
Okay, I see. Okay, thank you.
So, remember your main objectives when you are teaching a foreign language with comprehensible input. You want to be as comprehensible, as understandable as possible. We do that through gestures. We do that through translation. You want to be engaging. One way of doing that is through chanting. Mm-hmm. well, I tried to do a lot of chanting during the class. You know, it really works. It's really powerful.
Even on occasion, Ben has sung a sentence. You know, maybe you as a teacher can't do that too well, but there might be a student who can, maybe a very musical student who can sing and actually make a sentence sound like a song. It's possible. You know, you might have that in your class once in a while.
Mm-hmm. And you want to be engaging, interesting, yeah. And making sure students are there in the classroom, engaged with the class, interested in what you are saying.
Yeah. And I don't know if I can ask another question. I don't want
sure. All the questions you want.
What would you do if you be working with a higher level of language? Like, for instance, I teach Spanish 3, and for the 3 level, this is too elementary. So what variations would you do for a class that it has?
There are different possibilities. There are many ways to answer that question. Well, if your class is more advanced, you can do one word images or individually created images.
The individually created images, what she was asking about before, yeah. Right.
That's more complex. You write more text. Mm. It's more text with more complex structures.
Yeah.
You can go faster.
With this, you can go faster.
Yeah. You don't need to scaffold so much.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
I teach middle school Spanish, and I have 2 students who are going to another school next year. We're a middle high school, but they're going to a different high school. Mm-hmm. And I have 2 parents who are like, you know, is my kid ready? And I've been doing TPSR and TPR, I'm not using that old stupid book. But the new school is using that book. How, and they're like, they need to be on chapter 7, whatever, to go into Spanish 2. And the parents are freaking out and they're like, do you have a test for Spanish 1? Like, how do you bridge the gap between?
I have an answer for that.
Teaching this way and the traditional teachers that they're going into.
I have the same question. Thank you for bringing it up.
Thank you for asking that, because I was under the same situation, and I was in the same situation, and I was very worried, very worried. As a teacher, you know that languages are acquired in only one way. Students, people acquire language when they understand the messages and not the vehicle to construct those messages. So, you want to keep your job, so you want to do what they tell you to do, use a book, cover units, whatever they tell you to do. But then in the other part of the class, you can do this. You can do this. As a teacher, you know the book. The book won't help them to acquire the language, because there are too many words. The input is not really comprehensible. Yeah. We can't be sure that.
And the book can't describe all the possible grammar. That's impossible. Nobody can do that. Yeah.
Yeah. So because you want to keep your job, you do it.
I'm not so concerned about my job. I've been teaching forever. They're not going to fire me. I'm concerned about the kids who are leaving feeling not ready to be in that, back in the traditional classroom. And they're so nervous. They're going into like an IB program and they're taking Spanish IB, pre-IB or something. And they want them to be ahead of where we are. And they're so freaked out. And I've been doing it a totally different way, right?
Yeah.
Well, you're saying, make mm-hmm. sure you cover the information
they ask you to cover
that's in the book.
Yeah, and you know, you can do that. He does it a little bit each class, but you can make that little bit as little as maybe just 1/4 of the class, just 1/4 of the class, and 3/4 of the class doing this, you know, the comprehensible input.
It might be a good idea to talk to students and parents and tell them how languages are actually acquired. And tell them that, well, this is going to happen very slowly. It's not magic. It's going to take years. It's going to take years. And well, actually your level of proficiency never, well, it might be similar to that of a native speaker, but never the same. That's how we work. So also tell students, tell parents, tell administrators, you will acquire a language because you are understanding the messages and because you are taking part in communicative events. This is one of the strengths of the STAR. Interaction is so important because we want students to take part in communicative events. And as long as you are doing that, you are making sure acquisition is happening. You will be ready. You will, but you have to be patient. Saying something different would be fooling students. That's not true.
So would that be like some things that I haven't taught with the STAR until recently, but I've been doing TPR and TPRS for a long time and story asking. And when the students go to high school, like teach up to eighth grade, the teacher teaches grammar from the textbook, 1,000 words, and then they do regular tests and they come back to me, parents and students, saying, well, what happened? I was doing so good in your class. I had an A all year and now I'm getting C's because the teacher takes, okay, you missed an accent, half a point. You missed this, half a point. You didn't conjugate right, half a point. And they're getting C's and D's in the tests.
But you know, you could teach that punctuation all year long and they'll make the same mistakes. You know, so what they find from standardized testing is that on standardized tests, the students taught with comprehensive input do no worse than grammar. They might not do any better, but they don't do any worse, but they do much better in the writing and the speaking and the listening comprehension part.
Yeah, you know, the kind of grammar you want to develop is this mental representation of the language. You could actually try it with native speakers of Spanish. Take any regular person, someone who is not a teacher, and tell them, okay, give me three examples of preguntas absolutas, three examples of preguntas pronominales, and so on. And soon they will start to notice that. It's like looking at a constellation. You see the stars at night, but if you were able to actually be there, you will see that there are no patterns. It just, well, the sky, there are no patterns, it's an infinite space. Probably languages work that way. Well, that's what I have been doing. I talk to my students, not too much.
This is the metacognition, right? Metacognitive part of your instruction, but not too much.
Yeah, I tell my students, well, my objective is to be as comprehensible as possible. You have to understand everything I say. You're going to learn the language, the words, by listening to them enough times. I'm not going to ask you to memorize anything. You will be taking part in communicative events. And through this interaction, we are going to build a drawing, story, also a description. First, we're going to listen. Then we're going to learn how to write what we listen to. Then we're going to learn how to read what we wrote. And that's how it will work. We could use the book. I could prepare you for a test. And that's not going to guarantee you will be able to go to a country where the language is spoken and communicate. That happened to me in English. You know, in Mexico, people feel, administrators feel, schools feel that you know English when you have a certification. And not any kind of certification. It has has to come from Cambridge.
You know, Ben talked about, he was a graduate student. Mm-hmm. He went to France and he was so depressed. He knew the grammar backwards and forward because, like he says, he loves grammar. And he couldn't communicate basic things with French people.
Mm-hmm. And when so I went...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was avoiding French people because he was ashamed. I'm serious. He told us that. So he, you know, he went through the normal process and he got all his A's. I think at one point he became a doctorate student for his doctorate. I don't know. He might have even took the orals. He didn't finish writing a thesis, I think. And then he got disgusted and he got into teaching. So, you know, he went for years. He studied French for years and he went to France and couldn't do anything with the language. And he was an expert in grammar. Yeah.
Yeah, and they say knowing so much grammar, mm-hmm. studying so much grammar is not really helpful. It's actually detrimental to the language acquisition because you keep thinking like, what kind of ending should I put in that word? Like in case of Russian, it's so many different endings of the word. So instead of you learning just like two or three words together and just saying it, right? After like several repetitions, you keep thinking, oh, should I change the first word depending on like genitive case, feminine, plural? Should I change the second word? Or should I change the third word? But the phrase overall was like so easy to say, but you keep thinking of grammar and you end up just losing your moment. You end up just
being silent. if you keep monitoring and editing to yourself, you get nowhere, you know.
Exactly. And people will not take so much time to wait until you do all the calculations in your head, how to say like three words only, you know. People will just keep talking and you just end up being silent. Like not participating in language.
You know, I have a sister-in-law who was in a plane and there was a French-speaking guy next to her, and a native French-speaking, and she took French mm-hmm. in high school. And I don't know, something, he said something in French, and he says, oh, and she conjugated some verbs for him, but she couldn't have a conversation with him because mm-hmm. she remembered how to conjugate the verb, you know, do the paradigms for conjugation. But she couldn't use those verbs. So
that's
what,
correct.
Yeah. That is true. Imagine a regular American student coming to Mexico City. I think they will be shocked. And then if we move to La Habana, Cuba, that's going to be even harder.
Yeah.
But so my question's still out there. I'm convinced this is correct. I'm convinced after 2 minutes that this is the right way to teach. But I still don't have an answer, and maybe you guys don't have it, is what if my students are going with me for a year or two this way, and then they plop into someone else's class who's doing it the other way, and they're lost and they're failing. I mean, yes, they'll be able to understand better, but they're not going to know all the vocab in that stupid book. What do we say to those kids? Like, oh, I'm so sorry, but you're better at comprehensible input, or you can communicate better, but you're still going to fail that class because that teacher is expecting you to know bolígrafo, even though nobody uses it in the United States, right? I mean, like,
do you have more time with them before they move on?
No, and that's the thing, like our school okay. made it be like these weird blocks. I had them for Spanish 1B for 9 weeks of blocks, and that's it for the whole year. So they're behind, and I didn't use the book because I think it's old and ridiculous, and I'm not going to see them again. So yeah. I told these parents who are concerned, like, I'll do an independent study with them, and here's a dumb book, and we can go through it, and I can catch you up so you're where you're supposed to be.
Lori, I would like to suggest this. This is what I'm planning to do next year, because my mind now is in next year. This year is over, and I will cannot do anything. But I'm planning to use the 15 minutes of class and divide it into parts. One of these parts will be what we're doing here. That would be one of my parts of my 50 minutes. Then I'll have like a micro lesson in grammar that you can, I would suggest you to do that. Like a micro lesson. So like you select all the topics, the grammar topics that they're supposed to learn at that level, and do like a 10-minute lesson every day with those particular ones. You can assign them work, for instance, in Quizlet to do the vocab. You can use Textivate for the grammar, yeah. And you let them do that at home. And but you guide the grammar for them, and just select the topics that are more. You don't even need to use a book; just use it as a guide for the topics, yeah. And use the vocab of the book if they are going to continue with that next year as part of the stories. So try to guide the stories using the book vocab, the chapters vocab. And I don't know. That's what I'm planning to do. I don't know how it's going to turn out, but it has to be like we have to somehow compromise. In the sense that out of the 15 minutes, we can just divide it in several type of activities, one of which will be the comprehensible input, and the other will have to be the grammar thing or whatever.
Some kind of bridge. Thank you. That's awesome.
Yeah, but on the other hand, if you have them using vocabulary, if you have them using vocabulary that's in the book to write something, then you're grading them on output, and they're not acquiring that. They're not acquiring that because they're really acquiring with the input.
Yeah, but if you integrate it in within the stories, I'm working with the stories too. That's another part that I'm planning to use because I have been using during this year. So we create stories. I do PowerPoints with the stories, and then they create the story together. Then they do their own PowerPoint with their a similar story with the same structures that they create. So they repeat the same structures, but with their own characters, they change the names, they change the setting. And that's it. That's the part of the output of the practice that they do. And I think that they can do something like that, but the input part is the one that we're gonna build in there. Because this is still gonna take time until it becomes like the mainstream way of teaching. And I don't know, that's my 20 cents on that.
Jesus, how long have you been teaching this way?
I have been teaching foreign languages for almost 15 years.
How long have you been using the star?
1 year. 1 year, and I have seen the results. They have been great. In my personal experience, nobody has ever complained about that. Actually, students really suffer when they have to use the book. They don't want to do something different.
I'm thinking, like when this student moves on and the student moves on to a non-CI teacher, that student as much as possible should be interacting with that teacher using the amount of French or Spanish or whatever language it is, as much as possible, interacting with that teacher to let that teacher know that no matter what the student does in that class, that the student actually can use the language. So that gets in his teacher's mind. And if the student as the teacher is conscientious, he realizes that he or she realizes that they're gonna have to adapt to these students who can really use the language. If they're just going to throw them in the garbage can because they can't put the apostrophe in the right place or the accent mark in the right place, that's crazy.
Well, I think the high school student that has the guts to go up to their new teacher and say, you know, I came from class and listen to me speak Spanish. You know, they're few and far between. I think it's a wonderful idea, but I
you don't say she.
I don't know what's gonna happen.
The student doesn't say I came from that kind of class. You're talking to the teacher, and you throw in as much as possible. The student throws in as much as possible some of the language to show that they know the language. However, they got it. You don't say the student doesn't say. Well, I came from this kind of class. You don't challenge the teacher. You do it. You advise the student to do it in a friendly manner, just to show that you're interested in the language and you actually have acquired some of it. And this, you know, if the teacher is conscientious, the teacher's going to think, well, gee, somehow or another, I have to adapt to the student a little bit, you know.
I know what you're saying. I'm just saying that, you know, a student with that kind of confidence
in their sophomore year of high school is going to be a very rare special kid.
I have a question.
You know how Ben always says, I'm sorry, I'll shut up in a second, but you know how Ben always says, like, for those two kids who care about grammar, I think those are the kids who are going to be going into these IB programs.
Yeah. Lori and Corrine, I think I have something to offer, I hope. So I've been lucky enough to, I've only been teaching for 6 years, but I've been lucky enough to be in places where they're pretty open about how I can teach. However, at the first place I taught, there was a big district assessment at the end. And at the place I teach now, my colleague teaches from the textbook. So at the first place I taught at, I told my kids from day one, we learn language. You know, I told them the CI spiel, right? I was like, I'm gonna teach you like you're a baby because that's how we learn.
Yeah.
And I told their parents the same thing at conferences. Then, you know, 2 to 3 months before the district assessments, luckily I had access to the questions. And so I just made a Quizlet of the questions and we drilled it every day, right? Because, I mean, who cares, right?
Right.
And they did great and nobody was the wiser.
Very so nice.
Now, I tell my high schoolers the same thing. I say, I'm gonna teach you like your babies because you are Spanish babies, you don't know it yet. And come March or April, I tell the kids who are gonna move on in Spanish, like, I teach this way, my colleague does not. I need you to know that this is what you're going to be seeing. And so we open the textbook for the first time and the dust comes in, you know, and they're like, well, this is horrible. And I go, yeah, I know. And then we, you know, learn like a traditional classroom and it's boring and I try and, you know, liven it up. But then the kids who don't care, you know, they don't care. And I don't grade them on that stuff because it doesn't matter. But the kids who do care are prepared for when they go on to Spanish 2 and have a different teacher. So
say that again, say that last sentence again.
Oh shoot, I don't remember what I
said. Well, I mean, it was because it was about, you were making decisions about how to deal with the kids who didn't like the next level.
Oh, so the kids who don't like the next level, I'll give everybody the same assignment. But if they don't care, I'm not going to penalize them for not caring, because if they were put into Spanish 1 for scheduling reasons, or if they don't want to take Spanish 2, I'm not going to say, you know, F, because that wasn't their choice. But the kids who do care, you know, then I will grade them accordingly, I guess.
And how much license do you have to do whatever you want? Like Lori's up there in the mountains and she's got whatever she wants. Yeah.
Technically, we have, you know, the textbook that we're supposed to use, and my colleague, as far as they know, I use the textbook, but what happens in my room stays in my room. So,
so you don't have a lot of colleagues who are on your case.
Luckily, no, I'm very fortunate in that regard. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I can see how you could very easily start entering grades under the first three competencies with the system. With the speaking, we're not supposed to force output.
Yeah.
So I guess, you know, I guess I would have to get a buy for year one for the speaking, right?
That's what we did in Denver Public Schools. I went down there.
Like, what do you do for year two? For like, when do the students start? You know, how does their speaking proficiency progress?
Remember the 10,000.
If they do this,
I got you. Remember the 10,000-hour argument.
Mm-hmm.
It takes 10,000 hours, and we have 500 in a 4-year program.
Mm-hmm.
So
we incorrectly think, and the people in your district are back. The people in your district that chose those four competencies, you know why they picked them? Because they were the standard in 50 years ago. Nobody knew, because the research wasn't out there, that they can't output speech. They cannot write. And you said the first three competencies. I'm saying writing and speaking are impossible for a child in, after 4 years. And I've said this to people, you know, the big wigs. I said, why in the hell is anybody trying to get speech or writing output in a four-year program? You see how that's a new sentence? That's, you see how that's a 2021 sentence? You know what I'm saying? It's a 2021 sentence.
Well, so it sounds like what you're saying is that with this system, they don't start picking up on an ability to speak a little bit.
Not until maybe year three. You want to be really practical about it and a real serious answer.
Yeah.
4 years of high school is nowhere near enough time for them to be able to speak and write effectively.
Yeah.
That is a true statement. I can hear Frank grunting his corroboration. I'm going to say that sentence again, and it's about time we pull our heads out, you know, is children in level four are still raw beginners in terms of the research. We think a fourth year class is advanced, but there's so much wiring and neurology and neurological connections and everything else that has to be done in the unconscious mind. And it requires so much more time. I mean, think about our first language. We have 24/7, we're getting input 24/7. And we're still not speaking well after 5 years of 24/7. We only have an hour a day. It's just a mathematical thing. That's all it is.